Good morning, everybody. Welcome back to the channel. This is going to be the third video this week. I've just had a lot of really interesting thoughts pertaining to process and teaching for those of you guys who, you know, are really interested in learning the drawing process. There's so many different facets of drawing, from observation to techniques. I mean, my goodness, it's really hard for me to really narrow something down to basically get you guys to have that magic bullet. What you're seeing me do right now is a process that I go through every single time before I draw. This is something that I teach my kids as I am a teacher. This is basically getting warmed up. You know, I do a warm-up drawing per se every single morning, but this particular process is something that I usually don't show just because it's mundane. It's kind of ridiculous in a context of something that I do that makes sense for me. This process right here, drawing circles and then drawing lines and getting this, you know, the line on the paper in the morning, this little warm-up process is something that I think everybody should do, especially if you draw. What makes this observation, and you have to understand, if you're an artist, you're gonna look at this and you're gonna, or not, if you're not an artist, you're gonna look at this and say, well, I can do that. I can do that. Well, here's the deal. I highly doubt that you can do it like this if you don't draw on a regular basis, just because if you look at this as an artist, you completely understand what's going on. The lines have pretty much the same line weight. They're evenly spaced, okay? They're the same length, roughly. I mean, I do have some variables in here. And whenever you look at the circles, all the circles are roughly the same size. They're all evenly spaced vertically and horizontally. And I did that just basically out of a repetition and activating that muscle memory. What non-artists need to understand is, non-artists, I say non-drawers, if that's even a word, need to understand is this whole arm right here and holding the pencil, this is a disconnect, you know, a disconnect from my brain to my hand. I have to send impulses down into my hand to activate the muscles that are in my hand to execute what my brain is thinking. If you can train these muscles right here to recognize these impulse signals on a regular basis, you get something called muscle memory. Muscle memory helps you draw good circles. It helps you basically not have to sit there and fight with your arm on a regular basis to have good line work. Another thing you have to think too is, you know, just like riding a bicycle, you obviously, you don't forget how to draw. However, if it's been a while, you need to go ahead and kind of reactivate those muscles to get your best riding legs available. You're not going to go and jump a huge jump after being off your bike for 6 weeks. You know, the plain fact of the matter is, what I showed last time as far as thinking three-dimensionally, and that's something that is also another facet of this drawing process. What I'm going to do this morning is I'm going to show you kind of a, what's the good word? A collection of quote-unquote techniques that I mold into my process, okay? From variation of line work, to the muscle memory, to form, to thinking three-dimensionally. All these things have been combined into what I feel. And I put quotation marks, you know, with my hands, you know, wee quotation marks, because what inadvertently happens is whenever your brain takes over this process, your hand just becomes an extension of your brain. You start drawing and putting emotion and feeling into your drawings and your line work. It's like whenever I do, how do I do this? Whenever I'll draw a face, okay, I'm just gonna draw a really simple face, okay, really simple. Okay, so a really simple face. So basically, I want a kind of a pirate guy smiling. So what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna lightly get my form down, okay? So I have my circle for my head, okay? And I know the basic construction of faces. And then what's gonna inadvertently happen is once I start getting into it, I start feeling my way. I start feeling exactly where stuff needs to be in the context of the drawing itself. You know, and I start, you know, once I come up here, I'm thinking form, line, weight, character. And then once I hit that character note, I start thinking, okay, he needs to have kind of a suave look to him. So I'll go back here and I'll kind of give that those suave eyebrows, okay? And line weight, what is line weight? Line weight is variation of line to show contrast and give form, okay? So if I'm looking at this nose, and you guys can kind of already see where this is going, okay? And even in its very rude, crude format here, you can still see the form of kind of a lummox, kind of his face is coming back, and it'll even, you know, be defined more if I put like a smiley face in here. And again, you know, whenever I'm drawing, I'm always thinking three-dimensionally. I'm always feeling this form. This page is not a flat page. It is something that I reach into, and I can basically, already I'm looking at this, and I can run my hand over his head. I can feel that nose curving. I can feel the chin. You know, here's the upper part of the chin. Here's the lower part of the chin. I can see part of the underbelly of his chin. And whenever, you know, two things fold, like whenever you have skin folds, you know, like this, it has, you know, that crease in the skin. You know, whenever you bend here in your finger and you can see this crease, and this crease follows the line form of this shape and muscle right here. It makes me laugh sometimes because of the difficulty in this process, but the thing is you guys already doing this. You're already doing this three-dimensionally in your head, and you have this disconnect right here. And what happens is if you do not practice all the time, okay? Now, I'm not saying draw, you know, 15 hours a day. I'm saying practice. Practice in observation. Practice in, you see his head's gonna come back because again, his head's tilted this way, okay? It's tilted back. So I'm gonna have, a lot of things are gonna happen. Right here, you have this neckline because of his spine, and then you're gonna have these little folds of fat that come up, down, and then you're gonna have this chin which comes up like this. And you're gonna see the under part of it right here. And then you're gonna see, cause he's got a little bit of girth to him, this little fold that comes here. And I'm gonna redefine this chin. And again, thinking about line weight, whenever you have two surfaces that come together like this, okay? Like this, this line right here is gonna have a thickness to it and it's gonna taper off. And this line up here, since it doesn't have this gravity pulling down on the skin fold, it's gonna have less of a line weight to it. So whenever I come up here, it's gonna be a thinner line, okay? A thinner line, and then, let me do some hair back here. Gonna curve around. You're gonna have a little bit of a fall down here. This wasn't even the drawing that I was supposed to be doing today, but for teaching purposes, I think it's gonna be great. So, here we go. So, whenever you have those lines, you want to show a line that has a little bit of a weight to it. It all has to do with observation of life. It all has to do with so many different factors that kind of factor into the to the thought process of drawing. You guys, number one, you don't give yourself enough credit, okay? Because drawing is hard. For those of you who are learning, drawing is hard. And two, concerning line weight, whenever you have an object in front of another object, like if I were to draw this book on top of my hand, okay? Whenever I draw the line on this book, it's going to have a thicker line weight because it's forward. It's above. It's in front of. So whenever I do stuff like this, now I did this without even explaining or thinking, the nose is in front of his face, so it's going to have a thicker line to bring it forward. The thinner lines are going to be on top. The thicker lines are going to be in the bottom just because of how gravity pulls on a shape. Like if I were to do like a sandbag, the old sugar bag, here's a good example. The old sugar bag that animators use whenever they're animating stuff, you know, the sugar sack or the flour sack, okay. This line up here is gonna have a lighter feel to it. And whenever I come around, just to accentuate that form, it's gonna have a darker line at the bottom, okay? And whenever I draw all these little nooks and crannies at the bottom, and again, I've got this line of action and the motion, okay? And then I draw a little simple shadow to accentuate form. But showing it in front of something, getting that line weight, getting that stroke down, understanding the dynamics of what it, you know, what it is to have variation of line and staying loose. You notice I'm not focusing in really on a particular, see, I went a little bit lighter, and whenever I get to the bottom part of this collar, I'm gonna draw it darker, and again, I'm gonna keep drawing it darker because it's in front of the neck. And always thinking, you know, the chin being an area right here that has great form to it. And whenever it comes up, you have this cheekbone, you know, you have the eye socket right here, because here's his eyes right here, this little eye line. And here's the side of the skull, and it comes around, here's his cheekbone. And I'm not drawing it per se, I'll just give a little indication of it right here. And here is his mouth that comes around. Now there's a couple ways I can do it. Depending on the characterization of him, terror would be, you know, the bottom lip would be here, and the lower part of the corners of the mouth would be down, so the bottom lip would go up. So since he's happy, I bring it down. And these are things that just come with drawing characters a lot. I mean, you know, whenever I do exercises and stuff in class, and I'll try to explain things to students, a lot of times it's hard because of the fact they haven't developed that muscle memory, you know, and I have to find a way. You have to, as teachers, you have to find a way to reach the students, and that's, you know, that's part of teaching. You just can't put something out there and say, well, I don't understand why you don't get it. And that's something that as illustrators and artists, here, I'm gonna bring this nose down a little bit more, because he's kind of like a pirate. And again, you know, I'm gonna bring the, always thinking that round nose, because here's the top bridge where the skull comes out. It's gonna come out, and this is under the skin that you can't see, and then it's gonna come around like this. So I basically have this nose, and the shadow's gonna go right here. Okay, and I want this to come out a little bit more, and I've got my thing right here. What I'm going to do is, instead of talking, and I know you guys appreciate the talking, I've had a lot of people recently comment that they enjoy the talking, but to sit here and spend 35 minutes on a drawing, you know, sometimes is a little bit much for people. But in real time, it really helps you. And I think that, you know, especially today, especially after I've had decent success with what I did yesterday and the day before. So here's his hair that comes around. His hair is covering his collar, and this is obviously a design decision that I have to make. So am I going to continue this line down and reaffirm the form? Because you have to think of a silhouette. How is that silhouette? And a silhouette is being a shape or a form that has a defined direction to it. a lot of times character artists will ignore a silhouette and they'll wonder why the drawing is weak. This silhouette is just a portrait. So instead of covering up all of these wonderful lines, I'm gonna go ahead and I'm gonna bring this around. Here, we're gonna go here. We're gonna go here. A little bit of a knot. And then I'm gonna hide his hair. And I'm gonna redefine this, because again, that silhouette is important. Here, I'm gonna go ahead, since this is the drawing that we're gonna work on today, right? Okay, so we're gonna come down. And again, if you watch, I'm going in different areas, because if I can't figure something out immediately, what I'll do is I'll go to a different place and I'll start working. And what'll eventually happen, and this happens with me, I don't know if it happens with you, any of you experienced guys, the solution a lot of times will present itself just by means of revealing the drawing as I'm going through. You know, Michelangelo, and this is a quote that I'm sure a lot of people have recognized, he indicated that the sculptures were hidden inside of the marble. All he did was free them. As illustrators and artists, you should definitely have that mentality. There is a drawing on this paper. When you start, here we're going to have this, it's going to come up, it's going to put it right here. Okay. Then we're going to have this come off. You know, that drawing is there. It's there. You have to reveal it. There we go. And what I'm going to do whenever I'm done with this is I'm going to do a time lapse. Yeah, he's like, and two, it helps if you have kind of a demented, well, not demented, but kind of a skewed mentality. Because whenever I do drawings like this, I literally, I think in terms of situational comedy. He's like, hey, baby, how you doing? So literally that is repeating over and over in my head whenever I do stuff like this. So we can't forget an earring, can we? Got to do a big loop. And we don't want to disrupt this line right here, so it's going to be a smaller loop, and I don't want to disrupt this. And you got, and I'll do stuff on tangents. Tangents kind of destroy the flow, the rhythm and flow of drawings. And you have to really watch tangents whenever you have two lines hitting each other. Maybe you have an overlapping shape that kind of goes in the same way. Here's a tangent right here. If I have two lines coming right here and they touch right there, what that does is it puts them on an equal plane. One is not in front of the other. Actually, if I do this, one is not in front of the other visually, but if I overlap them slightly, then I no longer have a tangent of this finger and this finger. They're overlapping and it shows depth. And that's one of the things you really need to also think of whenever you're doing this stuff. Okay. So what I'm gonna define now is this collar, because that I really like that line that comes down. And I'm gonna come here and I'm gonna have an opposing line. You see this line goes like this, and then I'm gonna have the other one come around. You're not gonna be able to see this invisible line of action that comes around, and it's gonna come here. And I'm gonna go ahead and shade under here to bring that forward, okay? And two, since we're kind of being humorous, it needs to have a light and whimsy feel to it. So I'm gonna come back, I'm gonna redefine. I have this terrible reflection. This reflection off this light right here is just bugging the poop out of me. And this particular pencil has a sheen to it. So I'm gonna tilt my desk back eventually to get a better look to it, because I'll be sitting here and then suddenly my drawing will disappear. And I'm like, where'd my drawing go, man? Simple sells. That's always something that I always used to say when I worked in the apparel business. Simplification. Simplification. Don't overcomplicate your drawing. Don't put so much in terms of lines and convolution that you lose the silhouette, that you ignore the basic context and principle of what the drawing is supposed to mean. Have fun, but keep it simple. Make sense? Simple sells. That's always something that I teach my students. I had a student that is designing a toaster for a design project, industrial design project. And basically he went in and convoluted everything. It had the kitchen sink. And I finally had to tell him, I said, you need to simplify. Because at the end of the day, if your customer that you're trying to sell this toaster to gets overwhelmed, he'll shut you down and he'll walk away. Typically you have 3 to 5 seconds to grab the attention of a consumer. And if you can keep them for longer than 3 to 5 seconds, then you move on to the next level. And then from there, you move on to the next level. And it's basically a progression of salesmanship and intrigue, and you make things personal. So again, looking at this, it doesn't look like a lot, but it has a nice rhythm and flow. It's got a good silhouette. It has a nice presence. You can have you see the definition of the line work. And since I use this, it's really rough right now. So let's go here. Here's his, come here. And you always want to keep, until you go to your final, you want to keep things loose. I follow this girl on Instagram who is a very talented sketch artist, and I'm sure she's a great graphic designer. I'm not sure if she's animation or if she does it as a hobby, and I'm not going to mention her name. But what I like is I can see the progression and the enthusiasm. She posts stuff every single day. If you're watching me, then you know exactly who you are. She does dinosaurs and she does some other characterizations. And I like the fact that you can see the progression of thought. You can see that she'll experiment. You can see that she'll look at her art and she'll try to define it better. And then whenever she gets to this stage, and I really resist in telling her stuff, and if she watches my videos, she'll definitely know who she is. Whenever she gets to this stage, it's like everything clams up. She's so nervous. You can see it in her line work. She's trying to get that line so smooth, and she's not having any fun. This stage is where she has the fun, but when she gets to this stage, she literally, it becomes a process for her, a process that she doesn't want to go towards. And the thing is, this should be just a wrap up. It's like closing an envelope. You should just lick it and stick it. This is the final stage of the sketch process. You should have that same rhythm and flow. You should not trace. You should go and push the pose if needed. And that's why a lot of times illustrators are going to digital whenever they do this stage. So what I'm gonna do right now is I'm gonna put you guys on time lapse, and you're gonna watch this stage, the ink stage. And I want you to watch, because even though I have a thicker line here and a thicker line here, I'm gonna really accentuate that line weight, and I'm going to show you how, whenever I get to the ink stage, that line weight is extremely important, because it literally, it gives the final form to your drawing. So enjoy the process, and like and subscribe. If you're here for the first time, please share. I'm gonna be doing more of these videos that kind of show, that kind of flip the page. You know, whenever I was looking at art books and stuff, I would always look through and I would watch people draw, but they wouldn't explain the process. I want to explain to you how this works, how the chain of thought, how that muscle memory is important, how it's very important to draw every day, to observe life every day. And all these things, nobody told me this stuff at school. You know, they basically gave you an assignment and they wanted you to find your way. And there's a big plus in doing that, because either you're gonna foster or you're gonna fail. But at the same accord, if somebody were to sit down and say, hey, think three-dimensionally, practice every day, get the muscle memory down, because you have a disconnect between your brain and your hand. You're thinking three-dimensionally, and then you're drawing two-dimensionally to make it look three-dimensional. That's a long sentence, but at the end of the day, if you can get this muscle memory to where it is not a problem anymore. See, whenever you're in the animation business and the illustration business, they expect you to already have these principles down. It's not about the line work anymore for them. That's already been established. It's there. It needs to be there. Your squash and stretch, your knowledge of gravity, your knowledge of motion, your knowledge of characterization, your acting, all of these things are in you. And whenever you go and put them down on paper, that's where the gold is. That's where your expressiveness is, your line work, you know, your style. So anyway, thank you guys once again, and we will see you on the next video. Bye. So that's basically it. I'm not going to go way too into, you know, all the details and stuff like that. You know, I might come back later at a later point in time and flesh it out a little bit more. I might drag it into one of my electronic programs. I might even ZBrush this guy. I like the way he turned out. One of the side notes here that you guys probably need to recognize is doing a sketchbook. You know, I know that I've said, you know, you draw every day, blah, 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 blah. And it's kind of a thing that, you know, I believe in. But what you guys, especially those of you who are really interested in drawing as a living, for a living, you really need to have a sketchbook, something that is yours. You know, a lot of times I'll see business sketches inside of, you know, and illustrators that are doing stuff for money and stuff like that, with a sketchbook that has a bunch of business stuff in it. And I think that one of the things that we need to recognize as artists and illustrators is the fact that you need to have something for yourself. You really need to have something for yourself, whether it's a story, whether it's a character, whether it's something that's yours. You know, we do this whole art thing because we like to draw and we like to express. But the plain fact is, if you're constantly doing stuff for somebody else, you're gonna get lost in the mire. I worked for somebody for over 10 years and I did stuff for them and I really lost myself and I didn't have that ability to find who I really was as an artist. And that's when I started drawing every day and doing stuff like this. And I think that once you establish your passion and you find your passion, that it will open doors that you never thought could open. So that's an encouragement for those of you who are in business and doing stuff as an illustrator or artist. And need some kind of encouragement, because finding out that you've been working for somebody for 10 plus years and you don't want to go home and draw because you've given everything. And I'm not saying don't give a bunch whenever you're at your job because they're paying you. But on the other hand, you really need to have something for yourself. Okay, so that's it. That's my 2 cents. That's the 2 cents. Maybe I'll do a little 2 cents every single time. I really don't know. I'm just doing these videos because I like to do them and kind of give you guys some in the meantime. So thank you guys. We'll see you next time. Bye.